reading to you from the 13th chapter of Luke, and with the 15th verse. The Lord answered him, "You hypocrites, doesn't each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or donkey from the stall and lead it out to give it water? Then should not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has kept bound for 18 long years, be set free on the Sabbath day from what bound her?" Good evening, my dear listening friends. Again, this Evangelist Cecil Moe. And as you know, I'm a converted alcoholic, gave my heart to Christ over 55 years ago in a pastor's home in Seattle, Washington. Then 1 year later, God called me to preach, and I've been sharing Christ ever since. You know what, friends? You know what? You want to be happy today? Why don't you go out and witness to somebody, or tomorrow? Tell them what Jesus means to you. Now, if he doesn't mean anything to you, of course, you can't talk about it. But those of us who've been born again, who've repented of our sins, we've got a whole lot to say about Jesus. So listen, I am going to be with you for half an hour tonight. I just wish you'd kick off your slippers, sit back and relax. Pour you a glass of iced tea or a cup of coffee, whatever. Let's see what the Lord has for us, okay? If you have your Bibles with you, will you turn with me to Luke, the 8th chapter? Let's begin reading with the 40th verse. "Now when Jesus returned, a crowd welcomed him, for they were all expecting him. Then a man named Jairus, a ruler of the synagogue, came and fell at Jesus' feet, pleading with him to come to his house, because his only daughter, a girl of about 12, was dying. As Jesus went on his way, the crowds almost crushed him. And a woman there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years, but no one could heal her, she came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak, and immediately her bleeding stopped. 'Who touched me?' Jesus asked. When they all denied it, Peter said, 'Master, the people are crowded and pressing against you.' But Jesus said, 'Someone touched me. I know that power has gone out from me.' Then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, came trembling and fell at his feet. In the presence of all the people, she told why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. Then he said to her, 'Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace.' When Jesus was still speaking, someone came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue ruler. 'Your daughter is dead,' he said. 'Don't bother the teacher anymore.' Hearing this, Jesus said to Jairus, 'Don't be afraid. Just believe, and she will be healed.' When he had arrived at the house of Jairus, he did not let anyone go in with him except Peter and John and James and the child's father and mother. Meanwhile, all the people were wailing and mourning for her. 'Stop wailing,' Jesus said. 'She's not dead, but asleep.' They laughed at him, knowing that she was dead. But he took her by the hand and said, 'My child, get up.' Her spirit returned, and at once she stood up. Then Jesus told them to give her something to eat. Her parents were astonished, but he ordered them not to tell anyone what had happened." We've labeled this, "Meet Jairus, a great father." You know, men, the world regards as great. Well, we have kings who have kept the peace or conquered territory. Friend, I'm so glad I didn't live in the Old Testament times. Oh, I would have been in a whole heap of trouble. They had a lot of kings, and it seems strange. They had godly kings and ungodly kings. Some of their sons came over and took over, and their dad was godless, and they knew the Lord. Well, it's just like we have in our government today. We have a godless government. And friends, please forgive me for saying what I just said. We have a godless government. And how do you expect the nation of America, the greatest country in the whole world, can survive without God? Now, you know they've put prayer out of school. They've took Jesus often out of our churches. Hey, and many of our churches are denying Jesus, but they call themselves churches. We have synagogues. Of course, they deny Jesus. And we have godless religions. And we have, my stars. We've got all kinds of stuff going on in the world. And I'm telling you this, without the Lord, we are sunk. America is sunk. I don't want to be a bearer of bad news, but you know it as well as I know. The Bible said the nation that forgets God shall surely perish. Well, we have generals who have been great leaders in battle. I remember in World War II. Oh, my. And it was General Douglas MacArthur. I know something about MacArthur that a lot of people don't know. Him and his family owned a bunch of distilleries in the Philippines. But nonetheless, MacArthur said to the Philippine people when the Japanese took over, I shall return. Well, he did, him and 10 million Marines and soldiers and sailors, but he did come back. But you know, MacArthur, as great as he was, and he was a great general, no one can deny that, and General Eisenhower and all those great generals, but, you see, he made a mistake. He went against our president, and he got fired. Well, you remember athletes who thrilled the spectators? Of course, our great one was our great football player, John Elway. My, you know, friends, he is a very wealthy man, and he does a lot of charity, and he does a lot of good things, but he had trouble. He had a divorce, and he married a young lady, and I saw him on TV the other day, and he looked older than I am. You see, friends, if you don't put Jesus in your life, you age in a hurry. You know, if you read the Bible, there's been a lot of people way up hundreds of years old who served the Lord and went on. And as you know, Moses was over 80 years old when God called him at the burning bush. And I'm 84 years old, and I'm still plucking. I'm still shucking corn, as the old farmer said. I'm still trying to cut a straight row. You know what? You ever been in Iowa or Nebraska and seen these great, great, huge, huge cornfields? You look down those rows, and they're as straight as a die. Man, well, we're supposed to do the same thing. We're supposed to walk a straight line. Now, if you're going to come to Jesus tonight and you're at the crossroad of your life, you're going to look up and you're going to see a rough, rocky, dark road that leads to the foot of the cross. And then you look to your right, and you're going to see a great big broad way. My, the lighting is good. Everything is beautiful. But at the end is a burning hell. Now, friends, you're not so stupid to tell me that's where you want to go. You say, well, I don't believe in hell. Well, whether you believe it or not, it's in the Bible. Jesus spent more time discussing hell than he did heaven. Why? Because he doesn't want you to go there. How many times you've heard me say this? I've had people come to me, how in the world, Cecil, could you love a God that would send a man to a burning hell? Well, first of all, my God does not send people to hell. What? No, he does not. You are the one that makes a decision where you want to spend eternity. With your mouth, confession is made. Now, you say, well, Cecil, you know, so far I don't believe a word you say. Well, why don't you listen on? The Bible said, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So the more you hear. Now, I told you the other day, a prisoner called me from the prison, and absolutely he had no spark at all. I tried my best to reveal Jesus and what he meant to me and what he could do for him, but there was nothing. Now, see, the Holy Spirit has to work on him before he'll come to know Jesus. That's why it says, faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Now, I heard the word of God since I was a little boy, but when I really heard the word of God when I was 9 years old, and I heard Billy Sunday in Odell, Oregon. I'm telling you, I was sat on the edge of my seat as that great evangelist shared Jesus, and he didn't mince his words. He let us know that if we weren't born again, we weren't going to go to heaven. And I'm telling you the same thing tonight. Unless you've been born again, you cannot or you will not see heaven. Well, a view from above, men who have come to faith in Christ, men who have been faithful to their wives, and men who have been examples to their children. Well, why Jairus should be regarded as a great father? Jairus did the greatest things a father could do. Then a man named Jairus, the ruler of the synagogues, came and fell at Jesus' feet, pleading with him to come to his house because his only daughter, a girl of about 12, was dying. Well, now, that man knew that there was only one person right there that could heal him, and that was Jesus. You know, the other day, I got a deal from a church that they take a bus out and they take them out to their church. It's a county jail. Anyway, I got a deal and it says October 19th, so and so was healed of a knee. October 10th, so and so was healed of gallstones, and on and on. All there was about 15 things in that month that God had healed, but nothing was said about salvation. Friends, you can be so wrapped up in your religion and tongues and healing that you forget that that's not what you're called to talk about. You're called to talk about salvation. Christian friend of mine, that's the only message that will change a person's heart, Jesus Christ. Now, Jairus came to Jesus. Well, who was Jairus? Well, he was the ruler of the synagogue and a leader among his people. Let me ask you a question. How did Jairus come? He came humbly, and he fell at the feet of Jesus. He came with a troubled heart. Listen, friend, can you remember a time in your life when you've had to come to Jesus with a troubled heart? You didn't know which way to turn? Can you remember that day? What happened? Well, mostly you got relief. I've told you this story a million times. I won't go into detail, but I needed $5,000 so bad. I needed it. There was no way, beloved, I could ever get my hands on $5,000, but I had to have it. In 2 days, I had it. I never borrowed it. I never begged for it. I never went out and solicited. And that's something you'll find about my ministry. I don't solicit money because I don't believe in that. I believe if we're walking in the light and walking with Jesus, that the Lord will supply our needs. I truly believe that from the bottom of my heart. He's proved that to me 100-fold in these last 55 years. Oh, my. But you got to have faith in Him. You can't put faith in your church, your preacher. You got to put your faith in Jesus. Well, what brought Jairus to Jesus? Well, He had an upset in his home, a problem that he himself could not solve, in need of the touch of God on one he loved. Oh, friends, the other day I was disappointed, and yet I can't be. My son has the same thing as I have, COPD. He's on oxygen. He has to have 5 or 6 liters of oxygen a day, 24 hours a day, and they found a hole in his heart. Well, the doctor said there's a possibility that we can go in there and heal that hole, or plug up that hole in his heart, and if we can, then he's going to be able to breathe 25% better. Well, I told him, I said, son, boy, I'm praying for you. I really am praying hard. Well, he called me that day, and he said, well, Dad, I went through it, and he said, they just put me back together and says, we can't do anything for you. I said, well, that doesn't surprise me. That doesn't surprise me a bit. But we know that Jesus can heal that. Now, you know, when I was going to Bible college in Riverside, California, 54, 53 years ago, I came down with a lung tumor, and I was so bad. Well, in fact, the matter is that doctors gave me up to die, and I was one sick little guy. I was in bed for 3 months. But you know what, friends? Somehow, some way, I knew that God was going to heal. I didn't know how he was going to heal me, but I knew he was. Now, I know I wasn't going to go to one of these two-bit healers that makes money off of you and preens your feathers and throws the crutches up in the air. That's not what Jesus did. He ever did that thing, and it was an orderly matter. Well, anyway, so this doctor one day, my doctor was an unbeliever. I used to witness to him and witness to him. And then he said, well, Cecil, how do you know you're going to be healed? Did Jesus touch your shoulder and tell you? I said, no. But he spoke peace to my heart. I know he can do it. I know he will do it. And he did heal my heart and my tumor. He sure did. And I was so weak. I remember the first Sunday I was able to go back to church. I was so weak, my wife and son had to hold me up in the pew. And I stood up and I said, I want to take this time to praise God and my Savior Jesus for healing my body. Oh, friends of people, oh, that's wonderful. Well, friends, he can do it for you now. Now, I'm going to tell you something about prayer. He may not do what you want at this given time. God has a timetable, and I don't understand it, but he does have a timetable. Now, he may tell you, well, a little while later, I'll take care of this. But he'll always answer you. Now, not terribly long ago, my ex-pastor here from Colorado, who's now in Oregon, he had suffered a severe stroke. Well, my stars, in the morning, I started calling churches all over. I called the Dalles, Oregon, the church in Dalles. I called Millie Lang and Lash, and I called everybody I could think of. Pray for my pastor. So help me, John. That man is as well as can be. You see, when I had my cancer operation, Dale Freeman, my pastor, he has missionaries all over the world, and I was run number one on the prayer list. And God raised me up. Now, God raised up Dale. And not so long ago, see, he's making movies of this one man that I knew that passed away. Great man. He was a member of the Hell's Angels. They called him the Animal. Well, anyway, he's going to make a movie of his life and after he died, and I just can't hardly wait. But you see, God raised up Dale. Now, I told him, I said, Dale, would it help you if you could get on a TV program, a nationwide TV program? Oh, well, of course it will. Well, I said, I'll help you do it. Well, how can you do it? I said, well, you watch. I got on the phone, and I called my dear friend down in Florida, and he's got a worldwide TV program. And I told him about Dale. This is before he had the stroke. And he said, sure, I'd like to have him on the program. So he's going down there in January to get on the program. Well, the greatest thing anyone can do is come to Jesus. Friend, I don't care what you're facing today. I know, my stars, in the morning we have so many problems today. But Jesus can answer them, and he can solve them. But here, it said in verse 42, and Jesus was on his way. The crowds came and crushed him. Because his only daughter, a girl of 12, was dying. He came to talk to Jesus about his child, and that's only natural. Hey, listen, the most privileged children in the world are those whose parents pray for them. Those whose names are often before the throne of grace. The most underprivileged children. Those who grew up in godless homes and those whose parents did not pray for them. Oh, friends, I knew my mom was praying for me. And when I was going through all this, and then when she passed away, I could remember her. And she used to read the Bible to me and my sister and tell us these wonderful stories of how Jesus saved. We can pray for our children and expect answers. Well, look at the Bible examples of praying fathers. Noah, Abraham, Job, Joshua. Now, Jairus faced the greatest test of a father's faith. While Jesus was still speaking, someone came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue ruler. "Your daughter is dead," he said. "Don't bother the teacher anymore." Well, they said, "It's all over. It's all over. He's gone." When he arrived at the house of Jairus, he did not let anyone go in with him except Peter, James, John, and the child's father and mother. Meanwhile, all the people were wailing and mourning for her. "Stop wailing," Jesus said. "She is not dead, but asleep." Oh, well, he's awaiting news of the child's welfare, but when the news came, it was bad. His daughter was dead. Encouragement from Jesus at this dark development. "Fear not, believe only, and she shall be made whole." Listen, nothing takes Jesus by surprise. Jesus had prepared Jairus for this moment, the healing of the woman along the way. Listen to that in verse 41. Where's verse 40? Then a man named Jairus, a ruler of the synagogue, came and fell at Jesus' feet, pleading with him to come to his daughter's house. Now, then we said, a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years, but no one could heal her. She came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak, and immediately her bleeding stopped. "Who touched me?" Jesus asked. Then they all denied it. Peter said, "Master, the people are crowding and pressing against you." But Jesus said, "Someone touched me. I know that power has gone out from me." Then the woman, seeing this, that she could not go unnoticed, came trembling and fell at his feet. In the presence of all the people, she told why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. Then he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace." Oh, the Lord loves to do that for people. Well, walking with Jesus, we can encounter faith builders. Now listen to this. Listen. The daughter of this great father was healed. 51. When he arrived at the house of Jairus, he did not let anyone go in except Peter, James, and John, and the child's father and mother. Meanwhile, all the people were wailing and mourning for her. "Stop wailing," Jesus said. She is not dead, but asleep. They laughed at him, knowing that she was dead. But he took her by the hand and said, "My child, get up." Oh, friends, he raised Lazarus. Why did he do that? He wanted people to see his power, which anyone who's been around him knows he has the power to heal. He has the power to deliver. Look at me, staggering into a preacher's home, drunk, out of my mind, with no hope, crying and weeping. And he just said one thing, "Cecil, God loves you." The most beautiful words I've ever heard in my life, but I didn't believe it. Why would God love a no-good drunk? The other day I heard some homosexuals on TV saying that God made them that way. God didn't make a man a homosexual or a lesbian. He didn't make me an alcoholic. He didn't make you a drug addict. He didn't make you be unfaithful to your wife. No, he sure didn't. Well, healed by our great Savior, and nothing is beyond his power. Fear not, believe only, and see what Jesus does for you. You say, "Well, Cecil, I don't know. That sounds good, and I'd kind of like to believe it." Well, would you really, honestly? Now, you're unsaved, and you really, really want to believe that? Well, you know what I'd do right now? I'd bow my head, and I'd say, "Lord, help thou my unbelief." And then as God's Holy Spirit is tugging at you on your heart, and he is. If you've got any kindling in your heart or anything spiritual, he knows your heart. He knows that you want to trust him. You know, I always tell people, don't pray this sinner's prayer unless you mean it. Well, it doesn't do a bit of good to pray the sinner's prayer if you're not willing to repent and turn your back on the old way of life and come to Jesus by faith. There's no way. Anyway, if you have a tugging at your heart tonight and you'd like to trust Jesus, would you bow your head with me right now and pray this powerful, powerful sinner's prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, I confess that I'm a sinner. Lord, I'm sorry for my wayward life and sorry for the terrible things I've done to you and to others. Right now, Lord, the best way I know how, I'm opening my heart and receiving as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, I'd like to have you get on the phone and call 303-471-8534. Now, I will not use your name on the air. I will not embarrass you. I'll not sit down and write and ask you for any money, and I do not care where you go to church. I'm only concerned where you spend eternity. Oh, my friends, this could be the greatest day of your life. Oh, I'll never forget that day 55 years ago in that pastor's home when I fell upon my drunken knees and cried out, "Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner." Well, friends, I'm standing by my phone right now, 303-471-8534. Give me a call. Friends, for the past half hour, your host has been Evangelist Cecil Moe, and I want to thank you so much for listening. Please pray for our prison ministry this next week. We've got 3 services showing our movie. Pray for the mission. Oh, I'm so excited about that. We're going to have about 500 to speak to down at the rescue mission. They're cold, they're hungry, they're homeless, and we tell them the good news that Jesus saves. Oh, friends, what news. Why aren't you telling people about it? Aren't you excited? Don't you remember the day He filled your heart with His love and wrote your name in the Lamb Book of Life? Ask Him to remind you. Well, until this time next Sunday night, I want you to be good to your neighbors. Stay sweet. Keep looking up for this wonderful, wonderful Jesus.